R is for Roundabout and Romper Room, two of the earliest programmes on UTV. Roundabout began in 1959 with Anne Gregg and Ivor Mills as presenters. Broadcast every Monday to Friday evening at 6 o'clock, it was modestly billed in TV Post as a magazine reflecting Ulster news and views.
Working in Roundabout was one of the most exciting times of my life. I mean, I was just very newly into television. The whole thing was absolute magic. People like Bruce Forsyth, for instance, dropped in one day and gave a short interview. One in particular, I remember, is the day that Louis Armstrong arrived and flew into Nutt's Corner. And we went up to meet him, and we got a very famous Dixieland jazz band of the day, Jimmy Compton and his All-Stars. Got permission from the airport authorities to get Jimmy Compton and his boys out on the tarmac. So when Louis and his wife came down the steps of the aircraft, the band struck up When the Saints Go Marching In, and we were able to film that. Great moment that was.
Did you expect this kind of welcome?
Well, no, I didn't.
You do realize they're really glad to see you.
Yeah, okay.
Well, now, you better tell us right away what you're doing in Northern Ireland.
Well, we're playing here tonight. We have two concerts. I don't know the name of the hall.
The King's Hall.
The King's Hall.
What is the secret of eternal youth?
Well, the audience and myself, we love each other, and they enjoy my music, and I love to play music.
Roundabout regularly attracted three-quarters of the Northern Ireland viewing audience. It did so by a clever mix of local news stories and big-name interviews.
One outing with the film unit, I remember in particular, was driving with Anne Gregg down south of the border to a golf course just north of Dublin, Beltray, I think. A man called George O'Reilly in Dublin was a huge, great personal friend of Bing Crosby. He also happened to be an admirer of the sort of work we were doing in UTV, and he rang me one day. He said, would you like to come down and interview Bing? And, of course, it was an offer too good to refuse. It was an exclusive interview. It was the only interview he did while he was in Ireland. And we went down, and he halted his round of golf. I remember, instead of waiting till he got to the 19th hole, I think he stopped it at about the 16th hole, didn't want to keep us waiting, and came in and was absolutely charming. Charmed Anne Gregg, needless to say. And we had a lovely interview and drove back very happily the next day with a kind of a scoop, which was very exciting.
You know, Mr. Crosby, I feel most awkward calling you Mr. Crosby.
You call me Bing, or I wonder who you're speaking to.
Where did you get the name Bing from? It wasn't your real name, was it?
I was a little wee tyke. There was a comic strip called The Bingville Bugle, and a man in there called Bingo. So I was called Bingo, and then they took the O off, and now I'm Bing.
The departure of presenter Ivor Mills to England gave Jimmy Green a chance to spread his wings.
I hope what I was doing there didn't do your picture too much damage.
And I ended up then as the anchor man of the programme and interviewing people, reading the news, doing whatever came along. You know, out in the early days I'd be out and about with just a camera and a sound man, and me, bringing back stories for the nightly magazine program. And of course, that in those days, the film had to be edited by hand. You got to get back by 4:30 because the program was on at 6:30, and the film had to be spliced together and ready. frantic sometimes, yes.
Summertime.
Oh, Lord, we went up to what there was Nutt's Corner at that time. Could not get up. She said she hated the lights. She had something wrong with her eyes, and she always lights, Sir King. What did you say, son? It was a disaster. I don't know whether it was ever shown. I shouldn't have thought so. I might just have shown a picture of her. And I've been so looking, because I was a great fan, yes. And been so looking forward to it, but no.
When you did the concert in Hammersmith, Miss Fitzgerald, I believe Princess Margaret and Lord Snowden came along. Did you meet them?
No, I didn't have the chance to have the pleasure of meeting them, because they went out the front door and we were backstage, and it would have been too much a hassle for them.
The children's program, Romper Room, first presented by Miss Adrian, was an instant hit. The attraction lay not just in watching it, but in the chance to take part.
at that time, hardly anybody had been on television. So when a group of children from Dungiven or Auchnacloy or Newry appeared on the programme, the whole town watched because it was so exciting. And there was local photographs of them in all the papers, and they were very excited. I had 1,000 children on my waiting list wanted to take part.
For one young viewer in Belfast's Ardoyne, Romper Room was a babysitter's godsend.
I was the oldest of 9 children. Now, they weren't all born at that time, but I was the oldest, so there was a regular parade of new babies and weans coming into our house, so I was very, very, very familiar with Adrian McGill. Very familiar with Miss Helen. Romper Room, I think I sat through every Romper Room imaginable with someone or other of my brothers and sisters. So I knew all of that, and of course they were great celebrities in those days. We were fiercely interested in their lives and in their love lives, and they were the celebrities of the time.
It was a strange thing, the way it took off to become so popular. I think partly because there weren't very many children going to nursery schools, play groups and so on at the time, and so this was a great opportunity. It was free to everyone who had a television set, and children used to see what we did. And there was one little thing where we'd little stilts, which were little plastic buckets, when everyone walked around holding onto them and sang a little tune. But I could suggest that they got empty soup tins, and if Mummy or Daddy would be kind enough to sort of tie some string around it, then they could have their own, so they could do it while we were doing it. When I had 3 kids, it was time to let my mother not do the babysitting anymore. So I stopped doing Romper Room, and Helen Madden took over, and she did Miss Helen, and she was jolly good at it. And I watched it with my children. And people still call me Miss Adrian, although I'm married and I've brought up 4 children and everything. And I go into a shop and they say, "Ma, Miss Adrian, what about the grandchildren?"
He took her hand and woke her up.
Now, I had trained as a teacher at Stromulus for 4 years, and I was teaching in Everton Secondary School. And I thought, it'd be nice to maybe work into television. So I applied for the job, and I did this audition with 6 children, and I thought, good Lord, what do I do? But luckily, my old Stromulus training, I think from 4 years back, where we had to look after small children as part of our training, and I managed to fumble my way through some games. I think I made a few mistakes, but they said, fine. And they liked the way, because I made mistakes, and said, oh, well, I don't know that. I suppose spontaneity, and I got the job.
I've got a nice nursery rhyme book here.
So we did 5 programmes in a day, and we just kept going. And there were hundreds and hundreds of people queuing to get on, and no one ever jumped the queue. Child would come write a letter to get on, and I would have a little system, and they would join the queue. And so every week we would go through it like that. And they all got a little certificate and so forth. So, yes, it was a good experience, I think, for what, I don't know, but I really enjoyed it.
Romper Room had some very special props, much loved by its young audience.
Everyone had a little Doobie puppet, and we had a Mr. Doobie every week. Mr. Doobie says, "Do be a milk drinker, do be careful across the road," but we had the Doobie song.
I always do what's right.
And probably the best known of all was my magic mirror. When I meet people today, they say, "Oh, you're Miss Helen." And then they say, "You never saw me in your magic mirror." And they get really cross, and you can see a genuine grief that they haven't. I said, "Oh, but I'm seeing you now." And then I think, as a child, if I didn't see them, it would have been very sad that I'd seen their brother and not them. So it's a big thing to be seen. So this was the magic mirror, and I'm going to have to reveal the secret now. I started up and said, "Now, I'm going to look in my magic mirror," and I would hold the mirror up like this and go,
"Romper, bumper, stomper, do, tell me, tell me, tell me, do. Magic mirror, tell me today, did all my friends have fun at play?"
Then the camera looked back and today, I can see Helen, and I can see George, and I can see Alan, and I can see Simon, and I can see you too. And I'll see you all tomorrow in Romper Room. Bye-bye.